Right. So it's my pleasure to introduce today's feature speak, Adam Filippi. So Adam is currently at NHGRI, the National Human Genomic Research Institute, in the U.S. Before that, he was at the National Forensic. So feedback or.
You know your mic. Sorry, what's wrong? What's the microphone?
Sorry, you can see where. Fresh back for the new year, and we forgot how to do everything.
NHGRI. And so before that, he was at the National Forensic Science, work that he can't really talk about, apparently, according to him. So, and he before that, he did a PhD with Steve Salzberg in at University of Maryland, and that's where he and I crossed paths when I did my postdoc in Baltimore. And he was basically the experts in whole genomes, genome assembly, and was part of the developers for MUMMers, so some of the tools that if you ever do sort of comparative genomics, you'll probably be using his tool that he wrote before. So all in all, a superstar and a really nice person to work with. And do you want me to go before that?
No.
Okay. So without further ado, I'll let him talk about his some of the work he did when he was at Tiger. So that was before he started his PhD. And how he helped to use bioinformatics to solve the American anthrax case.
Thanks, Mom.
Okay. Yep, there you go. I see it up there now. Great. Yeah, Adam Filippi, all around nice guy. That's the best introduction I could have. Are we good to go, Will? Okay, good. To those online who can't see anything, you know, my apologies. Good. Well, thanks to Will for inviting me here today. It's my first time to Vancouver and my first time to the general Pacific Northwest, so it's been a real great trip. I've enjoyed it for that reason alone. And then today talking to some really great people here at UBC has been fun. So I'm going to do something I don't normally do. I like to talk about kind of the cutting edge stuff that I'm up to, but I'm going to put on my history professor hat today and talk about something that I did, believe it or not, 15 years ago. I can't imagine that it happened that long ago to me. It doesn't seem that long ago. But it was really kind of the second or third project that I had as a bioinformatician straight out of undergraduate, and so it was really a formative experience in my career, and it makes for a really fun story. And it's called Van Bug, so I'll talk about a nasty bug called Bacillus anthracis and the story that goes along with it. So currently, just starting on October 1st, I moved my lab to NHGRI in Bethesda, Maryland, and Sergey Korin and Brian Wallens are along with me at the moment, working mostly on whole genome assembly problems and diagnostic applications for cancer, infectious disease, and just genome informatics of all kinds. But I'll start with some acknowledgments and a brief disclaimer. So all of the information here I sourced from public sources, so if you came for secret information, there's nothing in this talk you can't find on the internet. And when I was working on this project 15 years ago, I was just kind of a very small cog in what was a very large investigation. And if you've ever worked with the FBI, you know they don't like to say a whole lot. So a lot of times I didn't even know what I was working on. It's like, analyze this genome and see what you find. Like, okay. You know, 22-year-old kid right out of undergraduate school. And I'm speaking here totally for myself on a personal basis, and I'm not representing the opinions of the government or anything like that. And all of the work that I'm going to talk about today I did while I was at the Institute for Genomic Research, primarily in Steve Salzberg's lab, and Mihai Pop was there at the time as well. A lot of the slides in this talk I adapted from a similar talk that Steve Salzberg gave recently. And the microbial genomics experts at Tiger that were working on this was primarily Jacques Revelle, Claire Frazier, and Tim Reed. And then kind of greater oversight from the FBI, the U.S. Army, and Paul Keim's group at Northern Arizona University. So, the case. Rewind the clock all the way to September 29th, 2001. So you'll remember September 2001 is famous for other reasons as well. Imagine how on edge people were at the time. And so when somebody comes ill with an anthrax infection in Atlanta, Georgia, it kind of raises eyebrows a little bit because it's not really an area that anthrax likes to hang out. So it was in the news that this photo editor named Robert Stevens fell ill and was diagnosed with anthrax after he returned back to his home in Florida and went to the hospital with kind of flu-like symptoms and just got worse and worse and wasn't recovering and was ultimately diagnosed and died from an anthrax infection. So that was in the news. Might be a one-off incident, but by the end of October, it was clear that things had gone really, really bad. So people started finding powder-filled letters at NBC News, the New York Post, and one letter was found at the U.S. Senate. And by the end of October, four people had died from exposure to these Bacillus anthracis spores. The original photo editor in Florida, then two in D.C., and one in New York City. And so now you can imagine kind of the panic that's spreading across the nation back in 2001. All told, there was at least five spore-laden letters sent across the U.S., so 22 victims who came with a serious enough infection to be admitted to a hospital. Five people died, including an elderly woman in Connecticut that was not involved with any of these mail processing facilities. She wasn't at the New York Post or any of these locations. She just had the unfortunate luck of some letter that probably came in her mail got cross-contaminated at a sorting facility with anthrax spore and unfortunately caused her death. You can imagine what a mess this made. So all of these letters went through the sorting facilities of the U.S. Post Office. 35 mailrooms were contaminated. And you picture a mailroom and all of the sorting machinery that's in there and how big of a space it is. Imagine the task of trying to decontaminate a room like that. So there was really kind of almost cutting-edge decontamination science that needed to be fielded so that they could go and clean up one of these mailrooms and make it operational again. And I think in some cases it took years before they could clean up and certify one of these rooms for operation again. Seven of 26 buildings on Capitol Hill in D.C. were found positive for anthrax spores. So here you can see a picture of some probably FBI agents in their hazmat suits pulling a vacuum across a HEPA filter at a U.S. Senate office building in the carpet trying to find spore. And so that's how they would find positives on these things. All told, it was kind of a seven-year FBI investigation, over 600,000 investigator hours. That's not even counting the hours of the scientists that went into this. And there's a good investigative summary on the justice.gov website. I give the link there at the bottom that kind of tells the story in full detail. And so when these letters started appearing in the various mail rooms, they kind of fell out into two batches. There was two letters that were postmarked on September 18th and then two letters that were postmarked on October 9th. And even the powders that were within those letters looked different. So you can see the post powder is kind of a darker color. It has kind of larger granules. And the powder that was in the letters to the Senate was a finer grain powder. So it points to the fact that maybe there was two batches of these spores that were grown up. And then, of course, because this is a BSL-3 category agent, all of this material had to be handled within BSL-3 facilities. And so here's somebody handling one of the original letters in a biosafety cabinet where all the evidence had to be processed. So all of the traditional forensic work, like people pulling fingerprints and doing traditional investigative forensics, had to be done in this kind of BSL-3 environment. Originally, three of the letters were recovered, and there was suspicion or concern that there might be more letters kind of floating around in the Senate office buildings. And so all of the mail that was, you know, processed by the Senate was kind of quarantined and then sorted through by the FBI. So here you can see them in kind of an ad hoc processing facility with these giant drums that, you know, might be filled with chemicals or something. But no, it's like 280 drums all filled with mail, like up to the brim. Mail sealed up. You know, here's a guy in the bottom right about to pop open a drum that might contain anthrax spore in it. You know, surprise! not the kind of day I want to have when I go to the office. And so my hat's off to the crews like this that actually sorted through all of this potentially contaminated material and then ultimately found the fourth letter. You know, and because this one was found at this stage, it was very well preserved and made for great evidentiary material. And so I think that was the letter that was sent to Thomas Leahy in the bottom right. probably in the 288th barrel that they opened, right, as it always is. And so to refresh your memory about the bug in question here, Bacillus anthracis is a potential bioterror agent, particularly because it sporulates, and the spores that it forms in this kind of vegetative state are very resistant to desiccation, you know, kind of resistant to UV, just hardy all around, and they'll happily stay there in kind of a sleeping state until they're inhaled into the lungs or otherwise in a place that they like to grow. Inhalational anthrax is one of the most severe cases because you inhale these spores, your body sees this foreign material, kind of carries it around, and then they start germinating within you. And then the bottom left is showing a monkey spleen where you have all these little bacilli rods floating around and happily growing alongside of the red blood cell there in the middle. And so it's a really nasty bug, but it also has a very famous history in microbial science in general. And go back to 1876, it was the first bacterium conclusively demonstrated to cause disease, kind of the foundation of Koch's postulates, and the first effective live bacterial vaccine developed by Louis Pasteur. And so it has this rich history just in microbial science in general. But then it also has a much darker history. If we fast forward 100 years, it was estimated that the Soviet Union's offensive bioweapons program had a production capacity of 5,000 tons of anthrax spore per year that they had the capacity to generate and then, if needed, deploy as an offensive weapon. So a lot of concern in the defense community, so that's why Colin Powell is holding up, I'm hoping, not a real vial of anthrax, but probably a simulant of some kind at a Senate hearing, talking about the potential for this as a bioweapon and why people need to be concerned about it. And so this is, you know, around the 2000 time frame. People know that it has great potential for harm, but there's still, it was the early days, there wasn't a lot of whole genome sequencing going on. And so the state of the art for typing Bacillus anthracis was kind of coming out of Paul Keim's lab at the time in 2000. And this is showing some figures from a paper from Keim's lab in the year 2000 where VNTR typing was state of the art. So this is looking for variable number tandem repeat copies throughout the genome. You have PCR primers that are lined up on the sides of them. You amplify and you can decide how many copies of this VNTR element are at each of these loci. And so on the gel on the left side, each column is an individual sample and they're kind of multiplexed by color. And then, you know, the copy number that you have at each of these various loci gives you the type for that particular strain, and then you can build these kind of rudimentary trees on the right. But the problem is that you get a lot of these polytomies and such where you can't differentiate between, you know, six strains that you know are different, but they all share the same VNTR signal. And similarly, there might be some that are not closely related, but they do share some of the same VNTR copy numbers. And so it's kind of a noisy signal, not very high resolution, but this was the best that we could do in 2000. And so the problem is when you get this attack strain that was isolated from the victim in Florida, and we want to ask what type of anthrax is it so we can figure out the strain designation, we have limited resolution. The story goes that as that patient had fallen ill and kind of before he actually died, a culture of the B. anthracis that was infecting him was flown via like Gulfstream jet owned by the FBI to Paul Keim's lab. Paul met it at the airport, you know, on the hood of his SUV. Picked up the sample, took it into his lab, and typed it that night, kind of routine, because this was obviously super high priority. And the result that came back was frightening, you know, and I've read interviews from Paul at the time and afterwards, because when he looked at the type, it came back as this Ames strain. And, you know, Paul is an absolute world-renowned anthrax expert, and when he sees that it's the Ames strain, the first thing that pops into his mind is, well, this is kind of the U.S. government's preferred vaccine challenge strain. It's in all of the labs. Anybody that's working on anthrax vaccines is using this kind of as their challenge strain. It's just the preferred research strain of the U.S. Army and other U.S. entities. And so this might be pointing to the fact that it's kind of a homegrown attack rather than something that's been environmentally collected or from overseas. But to be able to say, you know, whose Ames strain it was impossible at the time because VNTR analysis just tells you it's Ames. It doesn't tell you, you know, it's Jen's Ames versus my Ames. It's just Ames. And so the question was, if we go in and do a whole genome sequencing of that strain, you know, and think this is 2001 that we're talking about this, the first microbial genome has just been published a few years earlier at the cost of millions of dollars. So we're talking about a huge investment here to go in and sequence it and see if we can find distinguishing variants. So it was really unknown at the time if we would actually find any variants that would be able to differentiate between two different isolates of the Ames strain. But my home at the time, the Institute for Genomic Research, kind of under Claire Fraser's leadership took on this task, and we'll go ahead and sequence this and see what we can find. But it really was cutting-edge stuff at the time. So in the FBI report, some unnamed expert at the time called it Star Wars stuff that they were proposing to do. But Tiger was up to the challenge. So at the time, it was Tim Reed and Claire Fraser and Steve Salzberg had this paper in 2002 on the comparative genome sequencing for the discovery of novel polymorphisms in B. anthracis. It just so happened Tiger was sequencing a different strain of anthrax at the time, so they took on the task of also sequencing the Florida strain. And this is showing the history of this Ames isolate. So it was originally isolated from a dead cow in Texas in 1981. It was misnamed the Ames strain because the postmark that was on the sample when it got sent in had Ames, Iowa as the return address, even though the sample came from Texas. And it was sent to Fort Detrick and Frederick, Maryland, and then kind of distributed throughout the following years to various labs that were doing anthrax research. One strain in particular went to Porton Down in the UK, had the plasmids cured of it, so the B. anthracis plasmids are key to its virulence. So if you take the plasmids out, it's not a BSL agent anymore, and you can just do basic microbiology on it. And so that Ames-Porton strain is the Ames chromosome, but without the plasmids. There was also the Stern strain and the Pasteur strain. Each of those was missing one of the plasmids, but not the other, which also knocks down the virulence of anthracis. And so the first task, I presume, because Ames-Porton is avirulent and it's not a BSL agent, you know, it makes a clear candidate for sequencing because you don't have to worry about any of the danger or regulatory aspects. So sequence the whole genome, the whole chromosome of Ames-Porton, sequence the chromosome and the two plasmids of Ames-Florida, compare the plasmids to Stern and Pasteur, compare the chromosome to Ames-Porton, and let's see what we find. And so this really was kind of the foretelling of the future of outbreak genomics in 2002, and the quote from the abstract reads that these results demonstrate that genome-based analyses of microbial pathogens will provide a powerful new tool for investigation of infectious disease outbreaks, and that's exactly what we do today for foodborne outbreaks and public health outbreaks and so forth, as a lot of people here are heavily involved with. And this is all the way back in 2002 when each genome cost $1 million. And so it was really cool stuff to be doing at the time. The problem was that because this Ames-Porton strain has its plasmids cured, the plasmid curing process kind of introduces its own mutations into the chromosome. So they found this bag of variants, but it was almost kind of too many variants to make sense of. It didn't really give us a definitive notion of, you know, where this particular strain came from. So it was kind of back to the drawing board. Some basic biology was understood. We knew that there would be variants there to find now. But let's go back to the picture from the previous slide. And if we rewind the clock all the way to the Ames ancestor strain, there were kind of frozen stocks of the original kind of slants, culture slants that came from this cow that were frozen down at Detrick and just kind of never messed with since 1982. And those were just frozen in time. So you can literally kind of time travel back to 1982 and get the original parental ancestral strain of Ames. And so if we sequence that, it has both plasmids. It's from 1982, so that'll be the ancestor, and that'll serve as our reference for determining the evolution of the various strains that followed. And so given that, the hypothesis would be that as this was passed around the various labs, they would start to accrue mutations as people grew this up and did various experiments with it. So each lab might have its own signature mutations of Ames' ancestor. So go ahead and sequence Ames' ancestor and see what we find. So just the fast overview. I'm sure everybody here is familiar with DNA sequencing now. You have your original genomes. You fragment them into pieces. This was Sanger paired end sequencing at the time, so you sequence the ends of those sequences at great cost and effort. And then the assembly problem, which was my bread and butter at the time, is to line all of those pieces up together into the final representation of the genome. And assuming you've done that all correctly, it should be very easy to just identify the variants and have characteristic signatures of each of those genomes. But it was really an unknown process at the time because people had done genomes and completed whole genomes, but not really anyone had done many genomes of the same strain or many genomes really of the same species. It was just kind of we had one genome for each species. So not a lot of was known at the time about the variability between these strains. So there were some concerns that it's just going to be a waste of money. How do we know that this is even accurate over all 5 million bases of the genome, and is this a worthwhile endeavor? There were real some legitimate concerns about this, but everybody was kind of pulling at straws at the time and didn't have any other options, so let's give it a try. So went back. Tiger kind of pushed the gas pedal as fast as it could to get the Ames ancestor strain done, in addition to the Florida strain, got the full chromosomes and both plasmids completed, lined them up to one another, and absolutely zero variants found between the Ames ancestor strain and the Florida strain. It can be a little bit shocking to think, you know, 20 years had passed, This has been, you know, cultured in multiple labs and no mutations arose, but Bacillus anthracis is a very slowly evolving microbe, as we know now. And to quote, you know, my former director, Claire Frazier, when we returned these results that no variants were found, oh shucks. And that's a quote directly from a Wired article in 2011. We had spent all of this money to sequence these genomes, and we have nothing to show for it now. They're both identical. So a critical clue came from the team at the Army's Infectious Disease Research Facility in Frederick, Maryland, Patricia Warsham and Terry Abshire, who were anthrax and lab experts. And when they were culturing the powder, you know, the spores that came from the Leahy letter in particular, and they grow it up on a culture plate, they noticed that each of the cultures, each of the clones looked a little different when you grow it up on the plate. So the majority of them were this wild type, morphotype, as they call it, on the far left, which has this kind of crushed glass appearance, as they say, an irregular border. But if you let the colonies grow long enough, they would show these different morphologies. So you kind of have this bullseye on morph A and morph CD. Morph E is a little bit of a different color. And it was just a keen eye that picked up, hey, there's differences here. And so maybe those differences are due to mutations in the genome that are leading to that, maybe not, but that's a good place to start. So the hypothesis would be that if somebody had a population of different spore batches and they all got pooled kind of into the same collection, and then you pooled a sample from that mixed population, you grow them out on the plate, after 24 hours they all look kind of like the wild type morph, but if you let it go 72 hours, they each have their own kind of unique pattern or unique look to them. And so maybe if those are genetic differences, we'll be able to tease out what this population structure is, and maybe that'll be now our fingerprint for what the original source material was. So sequence all the things, go back, do a single colony pick for each of those weird morphotypes, and do a whole genome for each of those. And so, you know, this is back in the age of very expensive genomes. Again, it's kind of a big proposition to say we're going to sequence each of these individual colonies, but they did it. So the first one we started with was morph A, which is that kind of second in from the left bullseye type. So taken from the Leahy letter, single colony pick of that morph A, which clearly looks different. And to me, you know, not being a trained biologist, I'm like, well, if it's different, the genome must be different. So we'll sequence the whole genome, line them up, and morph A from the Leahy letter, Ames ancestor, and again, comes back. I did, I think, this SNP analysis. I was writing Mummer at the time to analyze these genomes. My memory's a little fuzzy, you know, it was 15 years ago, but I report back like, hey, you know, no, they're the same, no differences found, and, you know, the answer comes back to me, and remember, I don't really know what I'm analyzing, they're like, check a little harder, you know? Run that one more time. And so we really started scratching our heads. So I do kind of remember powwowing with Steve Salzberg and Mihai Pop, who were my mentors at the time, and thinking about all possible explanations, like what could possibly have gone wrong that we have two things that we really think should be different, and then we find out that they're not. So we go back to the assembly process. And at the time, kind of in the early age of genomics, a lot of people that were biologists weren't familiar with software. Now I hope everybody in this room knows to never trust a piece of software ever again when you run it. But at the time, a lot of people were very trusting of the assembly that comes out of the assembler program that, oh, well, this is the genome. It reconstructed it. But being a computer scientist, and Steve Salzberg and Mihai Pop both being computer scientists, we knew that there was areas for this process that could introduce error. And is there a way we can go back now and check our work and make sure that nothing has gone wrong? And so this really had us thinking about how can we prove to somebody that the assembly that our software has constructed is actually correct. And if you think about it kind of in Bayesian speak, that your assembly is the genome that you've reconstructed, if that's the true genome and you're doing a random sequencing process, what's the probability that you would have generated this set of reads? Okay, so if I've got my genome and I run random shearing and I do random sequencing, is it likely that I'm going to see some giant region that's at like threefold coverage from what I expect? Probably not. You usually see kind of random uniform coverage across the genome, and if there's these areas that have very high depth of coverage or there's areas where there's a whole bunch of reads that disagree with the assembly, it's evidence that something might have gone wrong. So given what we know about the sequencing process, can we then go back and look at the result and make sure that everything lines up how it should be? Modulo some sequencing error and bias that was somewhat well understood with Sanger sequencing at the time. So in that figure, the colored big fat arrows in the middle there are the genes that we're looking at. We're lining each of the individual reads up against those genes and saying, yes, they agree with that sequence, or in the red ones, no, they have an alternate hypothesis there. And so this led to this kind of concept that Mihai playfully called genome assembly forensics, where now we actually have to go into the output of the assembler and do forensics on the software to make sure that it put the genome back together correctly. And a lot of this work led to the QUAST package, which a lot of people have used recently for validating their microbial genome assemblies. And it kind of comes in two flavors. If you know the answer beforehand, you can just do a reference-based alignment. So the NUCMR aligner I was developing at the time, you just take the contigs, line them up to your reference genome, and count all of the variants. That's the process that we ran and found no differences. Okay, then you can throw the reference away and say, I just want to look at the original reads, and can I look at those and make some determination if everything is correct? And so there we go to statistical approaches. We look at the mate pairs. We knew that these paired ends came from size-selected fragments, so they should be a certain distance apart based on how we size-selected the library. They shouldn't be pointing outwards, they should be pointing inwards. Okay, so everything that we know comes from the sequencing process. The depth of coverage should be uniform. These are presumably haploid clones that we picked with no diversity in them. So if we look at a pileup in this multiple alignment, if we see multiple allele types, that's probably a repeat that's been collapsed on top of itself rather than population variants in the clone. And then finally, taking NUCMR and mapping individual reads back to the assembly and just make sure that each read has a place in the assembly and none have been left out. And that's really the critical step that helped us solve this problem, is that we were able to find reads that don't line up to the genome and they are proposing some alternative hypothesis, something other than what was constructed by the assembler. And so this shows exactly what we found when we solved the Morph A puzzle. So we were sitting in Steven's office the one afternoon and he proposed this hypothesis that, hey, if Adam goes and runs NUCMR, lines all of the reads up to the Morph A assembly, we'll just look for the regions that not all of the reads agree. Okay, so look if there's any clusters of reads that disagree with the assembly. I went back to my cube, ran that analysis, and it literally popped out kind of clear as day. There was maybe 5 or 6 reads, and this figure 4 reads, that all broke at the same place, meaning they lined up to the assembly at one location, and then they all stopped aligning kind of halfway through their middle, and then jumped somewhere else in the genome and started aligning again. And so you'll get a number of reads that just for like poor quality regions, weren't trimmed properly, and they just have low quality on one end, so they don't align across their whole length. And that just happens as kind of a random process. You'll see them scattered around. But when you see 4 or 5 or 6 of them all occur at the same place, it starts to become more than just a chance scenario. And so we showed this result to Steven, and then the hypothesis became, well, how can we fix the assembly to make all of those reads happy now so that they don't have this break? And so the pattern we saw for these 4 reads, that there were 2,023 bases separated. They would start here on the 5' end, the circles. They would go a little bit, they would break, and then they would jump backwards or forwards by 2,000 bases, and then the alignment would continue kind of right in their middle. And they all stopped at the same spot. And so Steven came up with the idea. He claims he went home and slept and came back the next day and, had the solution, is that if we make 2 copies of this section that includes those breakpoints, as I just illustrated there, and duplicate it like so, this is what's called a tandem duplication, okay? And so now the exact same sequence, now in 2 copies, and it starts, the second copy starts right after the first copy ends. And now if you take those same reads that were disagreeing with the assembly and you line them up now, they all have a happy home where they can align right across that green-blue junction. Okay, so I think I probably went into Emacs and like by hand duplicated this section at the time because there were no tools to edit sequences or do any of this kind of stuff at the time. Made the copy, redid the alignment, everything lines up, it's happy now. All right, so that's our revised hypothesis for the assembly, but we still don't trust the software. We certainly don't trust Adam hand editing FASTA files in Emacs, so we want to validate this with an additional assay. And so Jacques Revel's team at the time developed this PCR assay in that little black arrow gene there, and the primers were pointing outwards. And so if there's 1 copy, there's going to be no product because the primers need to be pointing inwards. If there is a copy in the form that we hypothesized, you'd have 2 of these black genes, and they would be pointing inwards. You would get a product of a certain size. You could put it on a gel and figure out how big it was. And so this was all at the start site of this 16S rRNA gene. So they went back and applied this assay to all of the samples they had, and this shows the original gel from the paper that Dave Rasko finally wrote up in 2010 describing all of this work. And Ames' ancestor, as we knew, there was no tandem duplication, but in the Porton strain, in the Leahy letter, in the Post letter, and the Daschle letter, they all had some form of insertion in the sequence of variant sizes. So it's kind of a mutable region, but a diagnostic signature between the Ames' ancestor strain, which did not have this, and the letter strains that did have it. And so we were able to uncover what the genetic mutation was that led to the different morphotype for the Morph A strain. We went back in then later. We really just got unlucky that we started with A, because if it had just been a SNP or something, we would have found it. But so it goes. We started with A and had to untangle that whole tandem duplication first. The other variants were a little bit easier to find. So Morph B got chalked up to a single intergenic SNP upstream of this gene that deals with the initiation of the sporulation pathway. And then all of the other mutations were also involving that sporulation pathway. And they were all either kind of single nucleotide SNPs or variable truncations of genes with artificial stop codons or big insertions or deletions or so forth. So ultimately, all of those genotypic variants were uncovered and linked definitively to these phenotypic morphs that we observed on the plates. And all of the morphs appear to be stable. If you took a clone of one of the morphs and subcultured it, it would keep its phenotype. They didn't observe any of these morphs in any of the parallel Ames ancestor cultures that people had in their collections. So the idea is these morphs are kind of unique to these letter samples. Maybe they could be used as a metagenomic fingerprint of where the source material came from. So the FBI went on to then develop four assays that they validated in their lab at Quantico. And they asked anybody in the U.S. that had anthrax samples to send it back to their lab at FBI for testing. And so they amassed this collection of like 1,000 anthrax samples from around the states and then ran these four assays on each of those samples to look for those variants in the various cultures. And so only 8 samples came back positive out of those 1,000 for all four morphotypes. I guess they eventually dumped the morph C and they had assays for the 2 forms of A, so the multiple duplications and the morphs D and E. And all 8 of those samples traced back to this parent stock from this RMR 1029 flask that was also held at U.S. AMRIID in Frederick. So kind of the great irony that the brilliant scientists that discovered this morph hypothesis were the ones that traced it back to their own institution that was the home of this flask. And so these were called the Dugway spores that were in this flask. It was generated in the Dugway Proving Grounds in Utah in the States. And it was a large spore batch that was grown up for the vaccine trials that they were running in the States at the time. So it's 35 different spore production runs, 164 liters of spore prep that was distilled down to 1 liter put into this flask. And so the microbiologists in the room can now start to think in their heads, well, now I can see why all of these variants popped up, because you did these huge production runs, you know, growing these bacterium, forcing them to grow very fast and then forcing them to sporulate. That's kind of ripe for inducing mutations in the genome. And then when you sporulate them all, they all kind of fix their genomes, go to sleep, they're in this flask, and then that population is now preserved inside of that flask. And that was held in Frederick. So by uncovering all of those morphotypes and then tracing it back to this flask kind of led the FBI to focus their investigation here at the U.S. AMRIID lab in Frederick. So in 2008, the FBI announced that they were closing the case because their primary suspect, Dr. Bruce Ivins, who was an anthrax expert at AMRIID, unfortunately took his own life after he came under intense scrutiny from the FBI. And I'll note that these kind of genomic analyses when you're doing forensics are always just kind of a lead into the case that point in a certain direction, but there was a huge amount of circumstantial evidence that also led the FBI to point their finger towards Dr. Bruce Ivins. In the end, they had done more than 9,000 interviews, did 70 searches, you know, followed leads across 6 continents. It was the most expensive and most complex law enforcement case in U.S. history. And the big break came down to, you know, a couple of smart scientists finding these morphotypes on the plates and a 22-year-old kid writing DNA alignment software at Tiger. And so this new science of kind of microbial forensics was born out of this, and the fingerprint that the morphotypes delivered allowed the investigators to narrow in their search. All right. So there was a lot of groundbreaking science and informatics that happened during this case. And unfortunately, a lot of it kind of went unheard for 10 years because the paper wasn't written up in 2010 because while it was an active investigation, nobody that was working on it was allowed to talk about it. But a couple of the things that came out of my research that, you know, really formed the projects that I started to work on after this, the concept of microbial forensics, so, you know, aligning 2 whole genomes to find all of the SNPs within them. So along with Stefan Kurtz and Art Delcher, I was a primary developer of the Mummer package, which did all of this whole genome analysis and the read mapping. The concept of trying to validate these assemblies so that an assembly is not to be trusted in any form, it's just a hypothesis, and you need to run additional validations to prove that it's correct. with me, Hi Pop, and Mike Schatz. And then this idea of read mapping, which didn't really seem like a novel idea to me at the time. I was like, sure, it's an alignment. I'll just map the reads to the genome. But Lior Pachter had a blog a couple of months ago where apparently the paper that Mihai and I wrote on this idea of read mapping is only the second mention ever in the literature of read mapping. You know, it kind of seems silly now that it's so ubiquitous. And the first mention was Phil Green and David Gordon's Concept paper 5 years before that were the first people to think about this concept of read mapping. And that's take the individual reads, map them to a reference genome to find the SNPs, the indels, the structural variants, and so forth. And then I think maybe the most important lesson from this example is that really every sample you look at, you're sequencing a population of cells. You know, unless you're doing single cell genomics, which you probably aren't, you're sequencing a population of cells, and if you sequence deep enough, you will find differences in there. And sometimes the differences are helpful, and sometimes they can just make things more confused. But anytime you're doing sequencing on an Illumina machine in particular, you've got to think in this metagenomic mindset. So where has microbial forensics gone kind of in the new sequencing era? This isn't a totally new project. There's newer ones I could use, but this one's also an anthrax example. Paul Keim's group led an investigation of this Scottish heroin outbreak around 2010, 2012. And it was very similar in a lot of ways to the Amerithrax investigation, that you've got an ongoing anthrax outbreak and you want to know where it came from and is it an intentional release of this pathogen or not. And when I was at the microbial, the National Bioforensic Analysis Center in the States 4 or 5 years ago, now the turnaround is just a couple of days from the time you get the sample in the lab until you grow it up, until you sequence it, until you get the answer of what strain it is. Incredibly rapid turnaround time compared to the years that it took for the Amerithrax investigation. And so this Scottish heroin outbreak is kind of a neat example of looking at an unknown outbreak that was coming from Scottish heroin users where they were doing deep injections of heroin into their tissue, and there was anthrax spores laced in that heroin, so they're not only injecting heroin into their body, but they're also injecting anthrax into their body, and it causes that nice picture on the top right that kind of presents as necrotizing fasciitis. And you get this really nasty infection of anthrax in the tissue. And you can imagine if you're a heroin user in Scotland, you don't have kind of first-class medical care, so a lot of times they would let this go until it progressed very late and it had a pretty high mortality rate. Paul Keim's lab and the lab that I was in at the time sequenced this isolate and discovered that it was from the Trans-Eurasian clade, which in contrast to the Amerithrax episode, where it was this Ames strain, which we knew was coming from the laboratories, this Trans-Eurasian clade is a very diverse clade of anthrax strains, and it was typed very closely to kind of naturally occurring or environmentally collected isolates from Turkey. And so the evidence kind of pointing that this is an accidental contamination event. Paul's group has continued to look at this, and just a couple of months ago even, they had a paper showing that this is likely kind of two separate introductions, likely accidental introductions of anthrax, and you can do that by looking at the whole genomes. So that's kind of a pause in the talk. I have a couple of things that my group is working on, but does anybody have any questions that they want to pose at this point in the talk? You guys are much quieter than the University of Washington crowd. They asked like 50 questions during this talk. Or we'll catch it at the beer and pizza hour afterwards. Okay, so where have we come in 15 years, and what is my group working on now? So we're still heavily focused on genome assembly and whole genome alignment. So our biggest project in the lab right now is this new assembler called Canoe. And as opposed to the 1,000 base pair Sanger reads that we had to deal with 15 years ago, we have PacBio and Nanopore sequences now that can produce 10,000 up to 50,000 base pair sequences. So the problems that I just all described in the previous slides about having these repeats be collapsed and having these type of duplications missed are kind of all a thing of the past now, because when the reads are 50,000 base pairs long, the genome assembly problem becomes much more easy. So back at Tiger, you would get a collection of 100 contigs out of the assembler, and then there'd be manual closure teams that would design multiplex PCR reactions to try and tease out all of the order and orientation of the contigs. Now, if you throw a microbial genome on a PacBio and get 50x coverage, it comes out in one piece straight from the assembler, very high accuracy at a base pair level, and kind of all that manual effort is gone. So, you know, from $1 million 15 years ago for a complete genome to now probably about $600 to get a complete genome off of PacBio. And then the Oxford Nanopore, which is kind of the more recent successor for single molecule sequencing, literally an iPhone-sized device that can stream off single molecules of DNA, and you can also close genomes from that, albeit currently at a little bit less accuracy, so maybe a QB20, so an error every 100 bases in the reconstruction. But you get a single closed chromosome out of it, and we've now tested that on B. anthracis, B. thuringiensis, B. cereus, Yersinia pestis, Francisella tularensis, Pseudomallea, E. coli, and all of those that we tried came off of that instrument in one piece when we ran it through Canoe. So really an exciting time for whole genome sequencing. You can even do this for human and get nearly finished human genomes that are as good as the human reference. For genome alignment now, we're thinking about if we can get cheap, complete genomes from it, how do we compare them all? So Todd Triangan and Brian Ondov developed this parsnip and ginger toolkit that can take 1,000 whole E. coli genomes in this example, line up the whole genome, build a multiple alignment, and then display it in this interactive viewer that shows all of the SNPs. So here are those little colorful barcodes or individual polymorphisms, and you can see how they agree with the larger phylogeny that's on the left. Oh, and so I'll note that canoe.readthedocs.org is the best place to go to get the assembler, and it also functions as canyoureadthedocs.org. And I got in trouble for that because then somebody wrote back like, no, I can't. You haven't put any documentation up yet. It's like, shoot, backfire. Harvest.readthedocs.org for large core genome multiple alignments. And then Brian Ondov has been working on this cool tool called MASH that I won't get into the details for other than to say if you have two whole genomes, it can very rapidly estimate the number of SNPs between them or estimate the average nucleotide identity between them. So in this example, we took every genome that's an NCBI RefSeq, so it's about 55,000 genomes. We were able to do an all-pairs comparison and cluster them roughly by species in about 46 CPU hours. So that computation computes 1.5 billion pairwise distances, so it's a huge number of distances to compute, but the algorithm that this uses is called MinHash, which was developed for very rapidly determining similarity of web pages. You can imagine how big the web is and how many web pages there are, so it's a very scalable algorithm, works very well for whole genome comparisons. And then given that database now, and we have a new unknown genome that we've sequenced, you can tell what cluster that fell in and what its nearest neighbor is in just 1 second of a simple, stupid linear search. Kind of even cooler, though, is you can use it for things other than just comparing whole genomes. You can actually compare two whole metagenomes to one another and compute their distance. So you think to the Amerithrax case where you might have a population within your culture and you want to compute the distance between two populations. You can also use MASH for that. So here we've shown it for Human Microbiome Project samples where there's 888 human microbiome samples clustered here, and then you run it through MASH. It doesn't know anything about where these came from. It's just looking at the sequences that are in there, rapidly computing the distances in about 4 hours, and you get all the stool clustered together with the brown, all of the mouth with the blue, all of the skin with the purple, et cetera. So completely unsupervised clustering that's able to take these microbiome samples and cluster them out by body site. So very useful for that. So all of this is kind of leading towards the idea of treating sequencing now just as a sensor technology rather than something that only Tiger or only the Broad or only UBC can do. This is something now that everybody can do. They have one of these MinIONs in their lab. They're generating data. And so think of it now as the weather station that's collecting all of this information kind of in a lightweight fashion and streaming it back to central repositories that can make sense of it. And just like you can predict hurricanes from weather patterns, the hope is you could predict infectious disease outbreaks before they happen, but only if we all work together, only if we all have this data in an open, publicly accessible form so that these type of algorithms that can process large scales of data can crunch on that and make predictions from it. So I'll thank my group in particular, Sergey Korin, Brian Wallens, Konstantin Berlin, Todd Triangan, Brian Ondov, that have done all of the development for the tools I presented, all of my former collaborators at Tiger and the FBI that I had on the first slides, NHGRI for giving my lab a new home, and then lastly, I'm looking for a postdoc for our lab at NIH, NHGRI, and we're going to work on all of these problems and scale them up for the kinds of data that these new sequencing technologies will produce. And then lastly, all the software I described is on our GitHub page, Marble for Maryland Bioinformatics Lab. Great, thank you. Yes. Yeah, so MASH is an approximation algorithm at heart. And so to some degree, you can tune the accuracy of the algorithm based on how big of a sketch you make out of it. And so you can predict in advance the bounds of the error that the algorithm will produce. But it's also an approximation in the sense that it's not actually doing a pairwise alignment of your whole genomes and counting the number of SNPs. It's a k-mer-based analysis. It looks at the number of k-mers that are shared and then tries to figure out, given how many k-mers are shared, how many errors must there have been or differences between the genomes. And so at that level, with the default parameters, say like, you know, 3 standard deviations of the error, it's still accurate to under 1%. So I think 0.003. I didn't have the slide in this presentation, but it's kind of surprisingly accurate. It's best tuned for things that are in the 100% to 90% identity range, so kind of right at the species threshold. The more divergent it gets, the more unbounded the error becomes. And so it's really tuned for these highly similar genomes. Yep. And so that'll bound what's called the Jaccard distance, which is the comparison of all k-mers, because it's only looking at a subset of the k-mers. And so you have known bounds in the Jaccard distance. There's kind of unknown bounds if you compare it to average nucleotide identity, because there's other variation just in the types of mutations that you find versus k-mers. Yes?
Following up on that, you were showing,
I talk about anthrax and heroin. Everybody wants to know about MASH. Yeah, no. One more back?
Yeah.
Yeah, so these, so the left picture and the right picture are the same samples. So the question is, what kind of lengths are the sequences in the MASH picture? So these are both the same samples, and it's showing that the clustering is kind of repeatable whether you use the assembled metagenomes or use the unassembled metagenomes. So the left picture is the assemblies. They're much smaller, and so it's much quicker to do the compute, so it's just 4 CPU hours. The unassembled bit, you have to look at all of the reads, so really it's limited by the disk and how fast you can read all of the sequences off the disk, so that takes 279. But it's very easily parallelized, so if you're running this across multiple cores or computers, you can make it as fast as you want.
Was there any DNA on the
Yeah. Yeah, so the envelopes underwent the full standard, you know, FBI forensic investigation. So they looked for fingerprints and they looked for trace human DNA and came up empty. So ultimate, yeah, that's beyond my involvement in the project. but ultimately it came down to, you know, there were a handful of people that had access to that flask that was determined as the source. And so they were all investigated kind of individually and, you know, either removed from the list or kept on the list based on the interviews and the circumstantial evidence. Right, now we're getting real outside of my expertise on the case, but if you go and read the FBI report that they put out, they do have, you know, their versions and their, you know, potential motives, but ultimately there was never really a conclusive motive found, and there were these circumstantial links about kind of general distaste for New York City and general distaste for the federal government and these kind of things that came up. So it was mostly media outlets and government that they were sent to. So that's kind of the key. Yeah.
What was the time break between seeing that those sequences, those alignments were deemed identical and then actually figuring out
I would say it was probably within a week. So, you know, it came back and we ran the NucMer between them and said there's no variance. And then they said, look harder. And then, you know, it was just a couple of days of us knocking heads together. And, you know, it was a day after we thought about trying it that I tried it and found them. So it was a pretty rapid turnaround. And then ultimately the real success was then we went in and got the PCR validation that showed it was a true variant. Because at this point, you know, when we keep changing our answer every day, you know, they come to trust you a little bit less, right? So once they did the PCR and saw it, I think that's when Jacques' team really knew that they had something. Yeah, Jen.
Two questions. The first is, did Paul and Claire go back and sequence the various strains with short read technology layer?
No, the original samples for this case were never kind of released or resequenced. Like the letter, you know, the powder materials were never resequenced. The PCR validations did show that the Ames Porton strain had a variant that wasn't included in the assembly. We did go back and fix that assembly and like resubmit the assembly to GenBank. But the individual letter samples and the individual powders were never reanalyzed.
Yeah,
and that's
for rare variants.
Oh, I know. People would love to do it, but you know, it's under the FBI's control and they control those samples.
Okay. The other question is, you know, 20 years is a long time for no SNPs, even within low molecular clock. Is that because that Doug Way vial, they sporulated it and then it just sat there for 20 years? Could you, with the molecular clock, make any conclusions about what that laboratory strain was doing?
So the Doug Way preps were made more recently than, you know, the 20 years prior. I think they were made later on after Ames had sat around in the freezer for a while and were grown up. But, you know, if you've seen Paul give talks, you know, B. anthracis is a bug that has no known molecular clock because it has this weird lifestyle of being dormant for years at a time and then kind of, you know, growing very rapidly and then going dormant for a long period. So you can't really put a molecular clock on it. And not a lot was known at the time about how the mutations propagate inside of culture, and it's still not very well known about how frequent these mutations pop up. And then to go back to the original point of that question, you know, the reason that we found no differences is because when we're looking at the original assemblies, we're always looking at the majority variants. And so when we sequence the whole culture, you've got all of those minority variants in there, and the assembler's like, oh, these are just errors because it sees it at low frequency, and the consensus is the one that it reports. And so the consensus was always unchanged, but there were always these rare variants that were kind of circulating in the populations. Yeah. Yes? Yeah, so the question is, how well do camera-based methods work on long reads given the error rates? They work pretty well in our experience, and so Canoe uses these camera-based methods for overlapping. And the overlapping problem is actually the hardest problem because you have the error in both reads not overlapping, so it kind of has an additive effect. So off of a min-ion, so you get a 20% error, and the other read has a 20% error. If you're trying to line those two up, it's really a cumulative error of 40% worth of differences that you're trying to overcome. And with a camera size of 15, which I think is the default for Canoe overlapping, we're still able to pick up those overlaps without a problem. Yeah, so MASH has a little trick that it does when you're giving it a read. If you give it a whole genome that's assembled, it assumes that there's no errors, and it just treats every camer as truth. If you give it a read set, it uses camer count to determine whether it trusts a camer or not. And so a camer that it's only seen one time in the whole read set, it's not going to trust, compared to a camer that it's seen, you know, 10 times, whatever your depth of coverage is. And so when it's reading these camers in and deciding if it's going to put it into the sketch or not, it keeps them in a little waiting area first to see if it sees more than one copy of it or more than two copies of it. Once it sees a camera a couple of times, it knows now this is trustworthy. It promotes it into the sketch, and now it makes it into the representation. So it's good for finding near neighbor, but you are correct that if you give it raw reads, you know, the nucleotide identity that it computes is going to vary from if you gave it the complete genomes because of the error that's introduced. But if the question is just what's the nearest neighbor, these kind of filtering approaches work fine to give you an accurate near neighbor call. Great. Well, thank you so much, and I'll be around for the next hour if you have any questions that you didn't want to be recorded.
So,
I
think you have not here.
Sure. It's going to have you first.